year is 1801. Or is it 1802? You're 31. Scratch that too. Keep it for later. Ludwig van Beethoven, you have for 10 years now been in Vienna. A couple of years ago, the first symphony. Bam! Then, the first quartets. A grand plan for many musical projects opens up. Lots of work, lots of studying. Your teacher has composed 104 symphonies by now. Mozart, well, about 626 works, and while he may be only 3 or 4 years old as of yet, Schubert has to compose about 1,000 works in 31 years of existence. And while Haydn was and still is the key to understanding most of classical music, Mozart's shadow shed a sublime yet mysterious shade on musical life. You know, your teacher, Haydn, can't take the fact that you want to pursue activities as an improv artist, a performer, and a composer. You devilish bad-tempered kumquat. To you, it seems the ends of classical language have already been reached, that everything's been done. You're carefully constructing works. And there is a form of distance that takes shape between you and the other composers of the past and the present. And by 1802, there is a sense of destiny being set for you. You're the first around to actually care about what gets published, when, where. You're very self-conscious to the point you're attracted to this idea of melancholia, or depression, as we might know it today. Yes, oh yes, yes, you're very doubtful. You obsess about quite a few very, very specific things. You know, you've known, for example, this grand humanistic poem by Schiller since you were 26, called The Ode to Joy, but it won't be until you're 52 you'll set it to music.
But let's get out of this familiar tone. You know, we may have hundreds of conversation books, hundreds of diaries from him and people around him. There is still a huge gap to fill if you want to get to the relationship between these and his works. And it remains somewhat of a mystery as to why he was so careful. Was it anxiety? Was it pure refinement? Why did he choose to control this? He was a part, and he knew it. And while his melancholia might seem inconspicuous, at the time it was rather seen as a sign of genius, like a birthmark, a destiny. Any self-diagnosis, any diagnosis helps one to turn something intangible into something tangible, to give it a name, and maybe even, well, draw strength from it. You know, it takes a huge amount of willpower, but I don't think Beethoven lacked any of that. Speaking of diagnosis, and back to 801, Beethoven's deafness was deeply increasing at the time. In 802, he produced not just music, but also a text, a rather famous text, the Testament, the Heiligenstadt Testament, which is, I mean, it's a kind of a fake text. But it is the turning point for, well, his entire life, you know, when he decides to entirely devote himself to composing.
girl, yes, tiny little girl, into this, out into this, before her time.
It's a combination of that. I feel I can have the two things, the two feelings simultaneously in my mind of happiness and sadness. And to me, something like that is melancholy.
The reasons that Beethoven brought up as being possibly at the origin of his deafness, according to him and doctors of his time, are as follows. A quarrel with a singer. Cannons blazing from outside his window. A bad fall. Standing up too quickly after a performance at the Vienna Opera. His stomachache, which came and went with more and more unrelenting swing. His nervous character and the resulting manic episodes of composing. His father beating him. Typhus fever. But none of these seem to coincide in terms of the period they appeared, or even with some of the symptoms he describes. However, in the beginning of the 20th century, a certain Docteur Marage wrote this, following firstly Beethoven's own descriptions. I quote, "When a deafness at its onset begins with the suppression of high-pitched sounds, and especially when it is preceded by buzzing and whistling noises, an oversensibility for shouting and wailing voices, we can advance the theory that the deafness here is caused by lesions of the inner ear, meaning, under the word inner ear, the labyrinth, its cerebral centers from which emerge the many branches of the acoustic nerve. Therefore, we have here a case of labyrinthitis." 3 years after its onset, in 1801, the deafness gets worse and follows a rather usual course. But he still hears words. He does not understand them. Indeed, he only hears vowels. Consonants have entirely disappeared because they last for such a short amount of time, often 20 times smaller than vowels. End of quote. Case closed? What we may infer is that his deafness was progressive and in a way kept his hearing sense ever more sensible during the first years of the 19th century.
So that seems all pretty well, doesn't it?
You know, we've figured out that, well, Beethoven had some kind of, you know, precise reactions and symptoms to his deafness, but there is of course, you know, a deeper meaning, I think. And it's been already hinted at in the first video, but I think that there is, you know, another relationship between his works and his life, between what he did and what he said. It's something difficult to figure out. You know, the Docteur Marage, which I just talked about, you know, he came a century after, and he was a bit of a whack job. And, well, the whole idea behind the symptom of loss of, you know, clarity, loss of consonants, I think it has one of the biggest musical implications of all. You know, as we all know, Beethoven was very famous for exploring as a musician the qualities of the pianos, of the different types of pianos he had at the time. You know, he had about 30 pianos, ranging from late classical forte pianos to the hammer clavier, which, you know, had three strings, had the several pedals, and had a very, very extensive range. And so he could in a way observe what the very subtle difference between each piano was in terms of, well, the only quality a piano has, which is articulation, you know, which is attack and decay, the relationship between the vowel and the consonants at the beginning, before the vowel. And I think here is kind of our key point, kind of our entering point into this. He has different ways of writing piano music depending on the piano. And I think that's true. If we don't realize that as performers, I think there is a little bit of a mistake in assuming that he wrote
every piece for the same piano. No, it's not true. Like, even for violins, you know, he worked with the German school of violin, which he didn't appreciate very much, the French violin school with Rod and Franz Clément, which he really appreciated, and British performers, you know, with the first performance of the Eighth Symphony. So that's something very, very important to understand, that each work is structured around, you know, a series of parameters that are really biographical. With this in mind, the kind of relationship between the attack and the decay of a note. And, you know, Wilhelm Furtwängler, who was probably the greatest conductor to ever live, said in an essay about Beethoven that Beethoven is all about the initial punch. It's all about sort of the entropy, the relationship between what is status, you know, what kind of attack, is it a T, is it a K, you know, for every chord, for every note, for every entrance of a voice, there is something like this. And there is a relationship between that and Beethoven's own feeling of music, and even Beethoven's own interests. Beethoven was entranced by Greek mythology. He was spellbound by, you know, allegorical visions of mankind, you know, whether they be Christ or whether they be, you know, celebration of life or, you know, striving, straining, heroes. You know, it's something he really, really, really gave thought about during his whole life, and that really led his own spiritual development. He agreed that music, you know, he is here to depict emotions and not things. You know, as he said when talking about the Sixth Symphony, the Pastoral Symphony. But still, it's about depicting things other than music. Well, things inside of music, which is emotions. So let me introduce you to the Greek tragedies and Greek epics, you know, Homer, the Odyssey, the Iliad, Sophocles, you know, with Philoctetes, Oedipus Rex. And they had their own specific technical and very precise way of transmitting emotions, not just through the contents of the text. They had their own system of representing within time certain emotions, you know, whether that is the rush of victory or the plight of anguish or the joy. For each of these emotions, I believe, and it is believed, they had rhymes, they had structures of verses around that. And what may have struck Beethoven about this is that it managed to survive for 23, 22 centuries. And for Beethoven, you know, who was just beginning to lose contact with the world, he wanted to find a way to make sure that his work could, you know, his compositions could go through time just as well and as clearly as the Greeks had. So he almost naturally took inspiration from the Greeks themselves and spent a good amount of time of the years around and after 18 and 10, really studying Greek rhythms, and not just mythology and the idea of an allegoric vision for music inherited from, you know, the Greek tragedians and their vision of, you know, music as a way of surrounding a person, and in music as a way of creating a separate space, a sacred space. And I'm taking Joseph Campbell's ideas here. But really a way of creating a ritual thanks to music. And, you know, that's why he wanted to extend also the bounds of music, just so that the experience of listening to music is a bit more continuous in a way, is a bit more unconscious. And it's the same. It's really, I think, the same with his use and his understanding of rhythms. We can see in sketches of the time that he actually tried to understand exactly what the proportions were in verses in the Iliad by Homer. At the time in Vienna, there was also a big interest with Music as an allegory, music as a ritual. You know, the magic flute is nothing but this. You know, it's the awakening, the initiation of someone to, you know, is it, you know, the mysteries of Isis, or is it masonry? For Beethoven, it doesn't matter. There is something absolutely incredible that is happening inside of Beethoven at that time, which is that he realizes that universality is achieved through this means of going beyond, you know, the context in a way. And that's really what I'm trying to do as well here. You know, I bring up biographical information just so that I can go a little bit further in, I wouldn't say the psychology, but in following, you know, tracing back his own thoughts from, oh, I'm writing a ballet on Prometheus, you know, that's 1800. Or, oh, I'm writing an heroic symphony or a pastoral symphony. Well, these, you know, before being ideas taken from the Enlightenment, these are ideas taken from classical Greece. This would help him make music that would stand on its own, that would not need any text. You know, in that, he has a divide. He creates a divide between him and Mozart and Haydn. Because unlike Haydn, he looks for an allegoric sense in music. But unlike Mozart, he doesn't want texts. There is this idea that his work is universal, that his ideas came from very, very early on.
Πολλάς διπτήμους ψουκάς αιδί προϊάψε.
He made music that became universal. Same thing goes for the Missa Solemnis. You know, the Missa Solemnis is an incredibly tricky jack. In it, he also uses a lot of Latin prosody, and he mixes them with his own developmental ideas about Greek rhythms in the instrumental parts. You know, he has sketches for, oh, what's the exact rhythm of the Kyrie? people started to actually see that, oh, well, he's actually doing something that reminds me of Greek tragedies. And I think it's also the reason behind, you know, his emphasis on repetition, on hammering the contents, because he knows that the true drive can get inside of our heads, right through our hearts, only through this kind of assertive conviction and not dominance. I really don't think so. You know, because at the same time, Beethoven was a man of contrasts because he wants the attack. You know, he will take an idea and then push it to the limit and then bring up something completely different. And that's, I think, really that comes from his own, the perception of his of the world around him through his deafness.
Fine. What if there is a relationship between this repetition thing and his deafness as well? I mean, when you don't hear consonants, it's just a string of sounds. There is no recurrence possible, there is no rhythm possible. So the only way of really getting something in your head is through just repetition of very simple musical bricks. Maybe that's why.
You know, him looking for the limits of hearing, you know, the very, very basis. And, you know, not trying to come up with a grand plan for new ideas, just trying to make the old ones as effective as possible. And that's, I think, also the origin for his passion for Handel. You know, he praised Handel as being the greatest composer who ever lived at the time. And he says, oh, it's very effective. Okay, maybe it's not as complex as Bach. And, you know, Bach was at the time, a composer that every musician knew, but not the audience, because every musician would, you know, perform, well, would study, analyze, you know, fugues and preludes and the keyboard works and everything. But his music wouldn't be performed. Whereas Handel was still very much hanging in the air, especially with the aura of the English aristocracy in the late 18th century. And, you know, Beethoven was very much looking forward to, you know, receiving full scores of Handel, and I think that comes from there. That also comes from his admiration for clarity and for classicism. It's like in classical theater when you have authors like Racine, Jean Racine, who also used classical rhythms and ideas of, you know, ordinance of a work like a temple or something. And it's something that current musicologists have also put their eye on. What, however, I don't think many people have pointed out is that I think that there is a relationship between clarity, inspiration, and tempo. Tempo is, of course, a very important part of Beethoven's work. And there is something really scary to observe with Beethoven's own handling of tempo markings and... It's strange because, you know, I just told you that he was impressed by the clarity of ancient ideas. But there were some ideas that he certainly did not like at all, which he inherited. Tempo words. He was less and less convinced by the idea that an Italian word could accurately describe not just the tempo, but also the character of a work. And it's true, it's kind of crazy to observe that, you know, an allegro can fit into as many shoes as possible. It's really, it's kind of scary, actually, to see that as well, to see, well, what have we been doing? And, you know, Beethoven himself, at the end of his life, in a letter to Schott, who was his editor for some of his late works, he said, okay, please wait for the publication of the Missa Solemnis, because I will give you the tempo markings. And he, well, died. Because this letter is from December of 1826. And he said, oh well, I mean, the first performance of the Ninth Symphony went very well, thanks to the tempo markings. And he says, we can't have any ordinary tempos anymore. One must be led by the ideas of unfettered genius. Okay, so let's break it down. Ordinary tempo, it's not... I'm kind of covering it up. It's not ordinary tempo, it's tempo ordinari. So, which is plural for tempo ordinario. A tempo ordinario is when you look at a score by Bach, you don't see anything. You know, there's just music, there's no allegro, no andante, and about 90% of Bach's work are like this. That was what Beethoven was against. He didn't think that music would be tenable, would be understandable, would be communicable after, you know, the revolution he brought, unless we drop out those words. And you know, that's why he really struggled. He tried to come up with new ways of phrasing, and sometimes really absurd ones. Like in the first movements of the first mass, it's quite a famous one, but I really like it. Andante con moto assai, vivace, quasi allegretto, ma non troppo. So he's like, okay, so that speed, but still, you know, go, but not so much actually. So he's once again trying to be very clear about things, but sometimes le mieux est l'ennemi du bien, as we say in France. And so there is a bit of a problem there. And in the beginning of the 1820s, he drops Italian words altogether. He just doesn't think they're amenable, they're trustworthy anymore. And instead, he just writes character indications, leidenschaftlich. Instead of using the Italian words, which have connotations with tempo, with actual tempo, he says, okay, maybe not, don't focus on the tempo, but try to figure out what the tempo is coming from, what I'm trying to tell you with the emotions. If I tell you allegro con brio, it's not just allegro. And enter our grand guest of the day, Rudolf Kolisch. He gave the premiere performances of Bartok's 3rd, 4th, 5th, and string quartets. By memory, Berg's lyric suites. By memory. He championed, even against, you know, astronomical odds, the original version of Bartok's solo violin sonata, which only, you know, came up in 1994, and he wrote an incredible book, a theory book, but also a book of visions and prophecies and history about the history of practicing and how should one practice. And so he wrote, I think, one of the most incredible musicological texts of the 20th century, Tempo and Character in Beethoven's Music. It's a two-part article that was written in 1942, but that was only published in 1993. And it's in two parts, Musical Quarterly, and he tries to, first of all, defend the fact that Beethoven's tempo markings are correct. And he tries, based on what the markings by Beethoven said, he tries to understand what's the relationship between the Italian word and the tempo marking, when there is a tempo marking, so that he can build up for the rest of Beethoven's entire output tempo markings based on the different units, you know, the metric unit, the tempo unit, and the hypermetric unit, one may call it, with according to the frequency of harmony changes, with the degree of virtuosity or grace that is in the music. He really breaks it down, so it's a long article. But for each example, he pretty much is on point. And one of the best points he makes, and it's a bit of a contradiction here with what I just said about clarity, is that, according to him, the ideal, the quintessential Beethoven marking is allegro con brio. And what is brio? Okay, so it's fire. Okay. Well, how does that show up? Well, first of all, brio, as he understands it, is this. Fast notes. Localized. Often just four or five. Sometimes eight. You know, taking the form of a turn, a mordent, a trill, a segment of a scale. That's precisely it. It's just fragmentary. It's just, you know, fire whizzling by. You know, something that you heard but didn't listen to. It's something that just makes your mind shiver or something. And for Beethoven, this you know, kind of brooding quality of allegro, of the brio in Allegro con Brio, is at the center of what the musical text, of the musical composition and text should be about. I'm trying to come up with a solution of how to integrate, how to, you know, put restraints, but also express that fire. Prometheus, once more. And it's absolutely fascinating to read Kolisch, because he's like, okay, well, okay, so we can see that, you know, beginning with Opus 2 and ending with Opus 111, we find no fewer than 20 times an allegro con brio as the first movement of a multi-movement work. But it doesn't stop there. According to Kolisch as well, allegro con brio features appear in many, many works by Beethoven, even those that are not marked by allegro con brio. You know, in the late quartets, and that's something I've quite... in my own, you know, been practicing in string quartet and in sonata, I've also noticed is that these fleeting figures of fire, they, you know, these small signs just sent out into musical space, a musical element that is first foreign or just passing by, turning the entire work over. You know, that kind of comes back to the idea of tragedy, of classical tragedy. The essence of classical antiquity, of classical tragedy, is, you know, an unconscious drive that at first is very, very small, but that ends up turning the entire story around. Oedipus, Odysseus's return, which, you know, could have lasted for just 3 days, but that ended up lasting for 10 years. You know, these little ideas are also something that come back to this idea of the grand ritualistic idea behind, you know, the late string quartets, the Missa Solemnis, of course. Beethoven's own understanding of clarity and fire, of, you know, of a hierarchy of musical elements that would be able to completely shift around the perspective of a work, so that, you know, in the Eighth Symphony, you have whole sections which are incredibly loud. And which is what gives the Beethoven character, you know, unfettered genius, unstoppable dynamics, whether they be in the loud or the soft. You know, sometimes it just makes my hair raise to listen to music by Beethoven and just be like, oh, come on, that can't be still forte. Like, why, why are they still playing very, very softly? You know, there are the two extremes, and of course, inside of it, there are lots of nuances in the writing and the harmony. But in articulation, Beethoven also stays very true and clear to his own intentions. You know, sometimes he has very idiomatic, almost abstract ways of writing chords. You know, in the Opus 110 Piano Sonata, there are those famous G major chords which feel like downbeats, but are not written on downbeat. They're written as upbeats, but upbeats to nothing. And also there's a crescendo. So in Beethoven's mind, there is an idea that tension must be kept up. There's an idea that writing can help the performer. Writing isn't just descriptive of the music. Writing, the act of composing, the fact of reading the music, certain signs can help not just keep the tension in the music, but keep the tension in the performer as well. I've talked about this with a few string players especially, and they told me it's simple. With Beethoven, the shorter it is, the lighter. Even though you have a dot, even though you have Kylan, you know, in Opus 132, there are big problems with this. And in the Quartetto Serioso as well. It kind of should have been his last quartet. You know, he wrote it, we don't know when he wrote it. It could be either 18 and 10 or 18 and 14. And the circumstances are quite strange, but I think fascinating, because Beethoven wanted very much to be able to control what he was publishing in what order. So, we have here, with the Quartetto Serioso, which is Opus 95, the Violin Sonata in G major, Opus 96, the Archduke Piano Trio, Opus 97, and the Song Cycle, Opus 98, La Bien-Aimée Lointaine, we have four works here which try to kind of bring down what Beethoven did until then, in terms of extending form, in order this time to compress it and to create more links between the movements, to create more, you know, swing between the energy of one movement and then the consequence of the next one. You know, whether it's a slow movement that is immediately followed by a fast one, or a light one followed by a serious one, or a slow one followed by the last movement, you know. Every time the configuration is different, but these four works, you know, they're very cramped. They're very dense. It's like nuclei. And the Quartetto Serioso is, I think, at the top of not just the inspiration. I mean, I don't think we can even call the Quartetto Serioso inspired. No, Serioso. Like, this is actual, you know, okay. You know, in 18 and 10, or 18, 14, whatever, you know, at the time he was writing kind of, sometimes not very good music. You know, he was very popular, but with pieces of music that are, even according to him, secondary. So he was like, with the Quartetto Serioso, like, okay, let's get back on track. Let's get back on track. Let's be really focused and let's write the shortest string quartet possible.
So very rugged, very violent work in which, in fact, Beethoven tries, so after the heroic period, he tries to make a sort of synthesis between the idea of, you know, a mechanical, not mechanical, an articulation of speech and form that is concise and understandable, and at the same time a scale of epicness, of grandness, you know, in the, you know, the, for me, the chorale of the last movement, the chorale section right before the end, is one of the most overwhelming things that there is in music, just because the, you know, the, you have this very, very dense work, this, you know, very difficult to actually pull off, to actually, you know, get into the mind of a character for just 4 minutes and a half or 5 minutes. and then you have another one without any preparation. You know, it is very, very extreme. I think there is a big sense of synthesis between the mechanical apparatus of the composer, of, you know, the sort of tone poet, you know, actually writing verses in music, not just, you know, diluting a texture or, like, you know, diffusing emotions. No, actually, you know, writing precise passions. I think that's what the Quartetto Serioso is about, just like the three following works, as well as, you know, maybe the Opus 90 Piano Sonata and the Opus 101 Piano Sonata. But they really corner the two edges of this strange period in Beethoven's life where you know, there was a lot of introspection, resignation as well. You know, the Quartetto Serioso, as he states himself, as Beethoven states himself, is not supposed to be played in front of a large audience. It's just for connoisseurs. There is also an idea of a conflict, you know, something that can actually feed off the music. Music feeds off of itself only because inside of it there are very conflicting, not just emotions, but manners of writing. You know, you have harmony that tells you to go this way, but then, you know, the melody might tell you to go another way, and then the dynamics are different or absent. And so there is this idea of, you know, putting antagonism to the very, very sharp edge of musical expression, to put conflict at the center, at the meeting point between, you know, tragedy and comedy, which is, I think, the whole point of the work. And in a way, the format of these works, you know, which are all very short, they actually allow to make all the more tangible the conflict, the antagonism, the almost the absurdity of, you know, lightness that follows utter despair. You know, all that energy is indefinite. That genius is infinite.
Signe, non pour être complet, mais pour retrouver le don des langues. Écriture directe, enfin, pour le dévitement des formes, le désencombrement des images. Tâche pour obnubiler, pour rejeter, pour désabriter, pour instabiliser, si, pour renaître, pour rassurer, pour écouer le bec à la défaite, pour regarder l'adaptation. Signe surtout pour retirer son être, geste du pied de la vie, ignorer les autres, geste de la vie, de la vie impulsive et heureuse à se dilapider, et l'art de la vie saccadée, espèce publique, de la vie à la diable. Signe non pour retour en arrière, mais pour mieux passer la ligne à chaque instant. Signe, non de tunique ou de palais, non d'archives et de dictionnaires du savoir, mais de torsion, de bousculement. La vie nouvelle du tactile, si étrange, signe si la débandade de la si réalisante et de l'enfant. Des foules alentour, des poussées antagonistes, des marimétriques, des convertis, signe non en image dans les lignes, signe non pour une zoologie, une avec des mains tous les mots freinés, accompagnateurs de nos actes et contradicteurs de notre retenue.
Faute d'aura.
Work on the world around you. Ingest it. Drink the world. What happens when the world hits you? Isn't a cry the sovereign proof of freedom? I am free to speak, to react, to be effective about the world. There is a special connection going on between the world and the I when I speak. When I say things nobody ever said, while surrounded by things that have always existed. Is this a flow? What is this flow? This, I've been covering up the word. This is improvisation. When I speak freely. It's too much of a complex word for what it actually entails. Let's preferably call it poetry. Though calling it won't make it come round. Poetry, in a way, makes us the template of nature. And nature becomes the template of human experience. One may find many, many theories about this, how poetry is about the correspondence between experience and reality, of the mutual enhancement between these two categories. I wouldn't want to put any timestamps over this specific topic, even though one would have the tendency of pinpointing it to aesthetic theories of Einfühlung or Théorie de l'affect, which were reigning over the 18th century. The 18th century informed our view of the world right up until today, though we have a bit of a problem. Despite those revolutions in thought, no revolutions in art were made sensible to their own age. Art seems to have started to have picked up in the 19th century. What was only embryonic, abstract, in the preceding one. There is an historical reason. There was an acceleration of thought and communication, an unheard of immediacy and clarity of technique.
This is an excerpt from George Steiner's Bluebeard's Castle, Notes for a Redefinition of Culture. It's a text which was published in 1971. It's from the first chapter. No string of quotations, no statistics can recapture what must have been the inner excitement, the passionate adventure of spirit and emotion unleashed by the events of 1789 and sustained at a fantastic tempo until 1815. Far more than political revolution and war, on an unprecedented scale of geographical and social compass is involved. The French Revolution and the Napoleonic Wars, La Grande Épopée, literally quickened the pace of felt time. Those who lived through the 1790s and the first decade and a half of the 19th century, and who could recall the tenor of life under the old dispensation, felt that time itself and the whole enterprise of consciousness had formidably accelerated. The decision of the Republican regime to start the calendar of human affairs anew with l'an 1 is an image of this great change. Even in the mind of contemporaries, each successive year of political struggle and social upheaval took on a distinct, graphic individuality. 1789, 93, 1812 are far more than temporal designations. They stand for great storms of being, for metamorphosis of the historical landscape so violent as to acquire almost at once the simplified magnitude of legend. Together with this accelerando, there occurred a growing more dense of human experience. The notion is difficult to set up abstractly, but it crowds on us unmistakably from contemporary literature and private record. The modern advertisement nostrum about feeling more alive than before had then a literal force. until the French Revolution and the marches and countermarches of the Napoleonic armies, history had been very largely the privilege and terror of the few. Certainly, in respect of defined consciousness. But these swept over the population with tidal mystery. It is the events of the Revolution and the Napoleonic Wars that interpenetrate common, private existence with the perception of historical processes. The levée en masse of the revolutionary armies was far more than an instrument of long-continued warfare and social indoctrination. It did more than terminate the old conventions of professional, limited warfare. As Goethe noted acutely on the fields, at Valmy, populist armies, the concept of a nation under arms meant that history had become every man's milieu. Henceforth, in Western culture, each day was to bring news, a perpetuity of crisis, a break with the pastoral silences and uniformities of the 18th century. Whatever ordinary men and women looked across the garden hedge, they saw bayonets passing. It is clear that the Napoleonic Wars and the revolutionary decades brought on an overwhelming immanence, a deep, emotionally stressed change in the quality of hope, expectations of progress, of personal and social enfranchisement, which had formerly had a conventional, often allegoric character of a millenary horizon, suddenly moved very close. The great metaphor of renewal, of the creation, as by a second coming of secular grace, of a just rational city of man, took on the urgent drama of concrete possibility. The eternal tomorrow of a utopian political vision became, as it were, Monday morning. We experience something of this dizzying sense of total possibility when reading the decrees of the Convention and of the Jacobin regime. Injustice, superstition, poverty are to be eradicated now, in the next glorious hour. The world is to shed its worn skin a fortnight hence. Don't misjudge or understate the Enlightenment. As light expands, darkness expands even further, the known unknown becoming all the more desirable. The unknown knowns, that which you don't realize that is at work in what you do, becoming more and more undecipherably important. Beethoven stood there. And these are crucial, these unknown knowns, because they are the codes of the classical language. They are the things we don't realize have an impact on us. Why does Beethoven's music strike so strongly in our hearts and minds? And why does it seem to lose its impact? Well, because we're now aware of the unknown knowns. And the known unknowns, you know, these would be things left to the license of the composer and the performer, you know, harmonic modulations, instrumental advancements. Beethoven built these free turning wheels on the already feeble shoulders of the unknown knowns of the classical code. the Romantic era was, you might advance, just putting on some clothes over those shoulders. And Beethoven's improvisatory skills are no coincidence here, because improvisation implies using unknown notes, harmony, ornamentation, and toying with them, knowing them. And that raises a very important question, to which I'll come back later. What happens in time, within time, when one doesn't know where one is going? Improvisation, to the eyes of Jean-Jacques Rousseau, is the ultimate presence of humanity as a single and lonely entity, thrust along nature and the flow of time. Improvisation, even perhaps more in the 19th century, is also the voice of man, of children, of woman, thrust about the mechanical advances of the world, in need of expression instead of production. Here's a quote for you. Sensations, percepts, and affects are beings whose validity lies in themselves and exceed any lived experience. They could be said to exist in the absence of man, because man, as he's got in stone on the canvas or by words, is himself a compound of percepts and effects. The work of art is a being of sensation and nothing else. It exists in itself. In a way, these works of art, those that stem from sensation, lift their own weight away from the composer. The work itself attains the dreamt of solitude and bliss of Wanderer. Beethoven was also there. He is also there in the mindset of improvisation as union with and separation from nature, from the world, and later from technology. And he is also in the dying wish that he'll thankfully be forgotten, cast aside by his own works. You see, art navigates, creates its proper coordinates of time. However, this solitude that the work of art has makes it all the more clear that there is an identification of man and time, humanity as the bearer of time. And flow, uncertainty, work is only skipping rocks as he steps from one bank to the other. And that didn't just happen in Beethoven, but also in the other arts. There is something in Goya, for example, in his work on the proportion between the character, the personnage, the main action, and the ground, not the background, because time wasn't the background with Beethoven and Goya. It is the ground, but it was never seen before. It's an unceasing semiotic ground around which the creator has to create focus. If there is such a direct link between us and time, we have to aim for it. Since reason has dethroned God, and since classicism has found an avancée, classicism and the Enlightenment have found a step further from the Greek and Latin classics. These latter two trusted theory and logic, but the classicism of the 18th century, since the Renaissance, they trusted the advancements of life, the advancement of proving a point. This meant that one had to go further and bring oneself forward in time, away from everyday nature and culture. Humanity as the controller of impulses around the world, through culture and away from culture. Humanity and time, however they may be moving, you know, as satellites, appendixes, supports to the work of art. We see art as the main thing around which humanity and our perception revolves, but humanity and time remain all the more unchanging in their view of one another, in that time will always be a harmful experience, a harmful presence in humanity's life. And from the point of view of time, we as mankind are the counter agent to its own existence. The conflict between us and time, the perennial quality of this conflict, is maybe not at the foundation of art, but at the foundation of leaving traces.
This is another excerpt from George Steiner. The thrust of will which engenders art and disinterested thought, the engaged response which alone can ensure its transmission to other human beings to the future, are rooted in a gamble on transcendence. The writer or thinker means the words of the poem, the sinews of the argument, the personage of the drama, to outlast his own life, to take on the mystery of autonomous presence and presentness. The sculpture commits to the stone the vitalities against and across time, which will soon drain from his own living hand. Art and mind address those who are not yet, even at the risk deliberately incurred of being unnoticed by the living. There is nothing natural nothing self-evident in this wager against mortality, against the common, unharried promises of life. In the overwhelming majority of cases, and the gambler on transcendence knows this in advance, the attempt will be a failure. Nothing will survive. There may be a cancerous mania in the mere notion of producing great art or philosophic shapes. You know, acts, by definition, free of utility and immediate reward. Flaubert howled like a man racked at the thought of that Emma Bovary, his creature, his contrivance of arrayed syllables, would be alive and real long after he himself had gone to a painful death. There is a calm enormity, the more incisive for its deliberate scriptural echo, in Pope's assertion that to follow poetry as one ought, one must forget father, mother, and cleave to it alone. For poetry, in that sense, one can read mathematics, music, painting, astrophysics, or whatever else consumes the spirit with total demand. Each time, the equation is one of ambitious sacrifice, of the obsession to outlast, to outmaneuver the banal democracy of death. To die at 35, but to have composed Don Giovanni. To know, as did Galois during the last night of his 21-year existence, that the pages that he was writing would alter the future forms of algebra and of space. Perhaps an insane conceit, using that term in its stylistic sense, but one that is the transcendent source of classic culture. We hear it proclaimed at the close of Pindar's third Pythian ode in Latimer's version. I will work out the divinity that is busy within my mind and tend the means that are mine. Might God only give me luxury and its power, I hope I should find glory that would rise higher thereafter. Nestor and Sarpedon of Lycia, we know, men's speech from the sounding words that smiths of song in their wisdom built to beauty. In the glory of poetry, achievement of men blossoms long, but of that the accomplishment is given to few. Note the modulation from poetic action to aristocratic truth. It is not accidental. The trope of immortality persists in Western culture, is central to it, from Pindar to the time of Mallarmé's vision of the livre, tenté à son insu par quiconque a écrit, which is the very aim of the universe. The obsession is crystallized once more, memorably, in Éluard's phrase, le dur désir de durer. Without such harsh longing, there may be human love and justice, mercy and scruple. But can there be a true culture? Can civilization, as we know it, be underwritten by an immanent view of the personal and social reality? Can it be vital without a logic of relation between the divinity that is busy within my mind and the hunger for a glory that would rise higher thereafter? And it is precisely that logic, with its inference of active afterlife, and in and through artistic intellectual creation, which is, in this relationship, is religious. This logic and its idiom are now eroded. The notion, axiomatic in a classic art and thought, of sacrificing present life, present humanity, to the marginal chance of future literary or intellectual renown grates the modern nerves. Going back to Goya, Beethoven,
also improvisation and trying to focus on the objective of experience and sense as a ground for life, we have to recreate the fleeting and relative sense of the arrow of time. Let me take an example. What was seen as repeatable or, you know, helpful for memory, like large-scale repetitions in the classical era, in classical music, was seen as absolutely unavoidable by Beethoven's time. And where some smaller musical units, such as themes, were, you know, in Haydn and Mozart, stated once or twice in full length before a transition or a contrasting element, Beethoven slices the theme into motives and launches it in innumerable iterations, losing and strengthening the concept of identity for such a motif. You know, he is stretching it in the micro or the macro. But the conflict of forms, of the understandability of form and the closeness that, you know, a Beethoven motif has to our emotions, it's close. That actually, that relationship changes in Beethoven's life. In his own creative life, you know, in his heroic period, the conflict is, it's at the center of the work's parameters. You know, there are great contrasts, immense gaps of meaning that you have to jump through to conquer the form, and, you know, there are nuclei of meaning. You know, either, it's a fight, either, you know, form or fantasy can come out alive of, well, say, the Opus 59 string quartets. Maybe Opus 59 number 2 has fantasy having the upper hand, while Opus 59 number 3 has kind of a mix of both. But, you know, as time goes on, Beethoven loosens the imprint form has on the work's material. You know, instead of form being tightly knit to its own constituents, it is wholly novel, completely new, without need of a particular undercurrent conflict. Therefore, you know, in late Beethoven, we have the addition of movements, the elision of movements, of sections, of entire emotions. But this is just Beethoven finding a homely stead for his fantasy to walk about. You know, finding a strange world of curious coordinates and vectors. Not for the arrow of time, but for the arrow of fantasy. You know, he probably doesn't feel flow
the way we do, and yet he wants us to experience it as he does. So, improvisation, this is about walking. It's about the pacing of experience. Maybe a deaf composer doesn't realize how much effort is put into performance by just looking at a performer. So that forces him to go deeper into the extremes of tempo. But, you know, there is a flame here that has to blow strongly. And it's not just within the works, it's in between the works. You know, the chronology of what happens in his life between 1803 and 1812 or 1811, that's absolutely not normal. You know, it's a grave misconception of today that artists follow and get inspired by their times, by their zeitgeist. But on the retrospect of any era, it seems that art brings forth prematurely what is to happen in the world. You know, to throw it in the world before it is fully formed there, before it can be translated into technology or efficiency. Trains didn't exist until the 1830s? Well, I mean, Accelerando and Ritenutos existed way before that, just like the concept of evolution. You know, one shouldn't deny art's ability to startle you. Beethoven's compositions probably startled himself before any other was startled by it. You know, hence his writing it, hence his working it out. Everything in this strange music is designed to mess with how we usually take in the world. You know, the push and pull effect of rhythm on us. It's so strange. At each repetition of a motif, we feel both hurried and comfortable. And it's up to the performer to choose what he inflicts on your ears and your eyes. Eyes are important because they can signal the ultimate characteristic of Beethoven's music: fire. Figures of secondary importance to our ears, but maybe not to our craving of sense. You know, rumbling noises, chaotic restlessness, all of this giving life to structure around it, like a light glancing through a deep cave. Some of Beethoven's works and their endings, and quite a few actually, end with dashes of light instead of music. We're not supposed to count individual pitches, to decipher rhythms and polyphony. You know, Beethoven throws these away because that's not how impact works. Instead, it's just waves of light and sound particles putting an imprint of their velocity on you. Music? Puh. Intangible. We may have scores, but there is no source to music. There is only direction. Hence also this sometimes nauseatingly aching feeling of having to leave a slow movement. Because direction of music and music, they don't care about us. And not, you know, they don't care about Beethoven, but not just him, about us too. But you know what? Music as a whole needs these boundaries to movements, to phrases. Otherwise, how can it be remembered unless a theme bears structure and repetition? How can it stay in our mind? There is
however, one exception. The songful cavatina. There is a formless density that takes place in a completely subjective and arbitrary point of the work. It's absolutely hollow, and to me it's the musical representation of amnesia, and at the same time it's the embodiment of emotion as I can feel it, because you crave for it. Music actually cares about you. It cares that you should learn from it. Beethoven's works are vastly different in architecture in that regard of direction and having to leave the experience of something and going to the next one. Observe, for example, why he would choose to put a slow movement after a moderately fast first one. Or instead, put a scherzo after the opening movement. Or why sometimes he dismisses the idea of having a slow or a fast movement altogether. Or even a last movement, or even a first movement. Why did he choose? Well, he didn't. The music dictated to him. It's not about energy. I mean, of course it's about energy, because, you know, the first movement of the Ninth Symphony has such a tension that we can't go straight to the meditation of the slow movement. We have to, you know, let go some of the steam in the scherzo. You know, you can't put everything in a sonata, in a multi-movement work. However multi it is, it must remain united and make its contradictions clear. The Waldstein Sonata's original slow movement, the Andante Favori, was much longer and characterful and lighter than the one we have today, which is quite plodding. But it didn't fit, according to Beethoven, the original one, because the other two movements around it are already dealing with light. And you know, having long motifs in the second movement would absolutely ruin the blissful first statement of the last movement, spoiling us of the reward of listening to something sublime, something circumscribed. Beethoven doesn't play with us. He isn't perverse. He gives, but he means to give at certain moments. Hence, all those spare, bare repetitions of entire sections to create
in us a desire for not just momentum, but for newness. This creates a chaos in perception, the chaos of our perception and of our constant intake of the world. This engenders the order of the work. The chaos of the world necessitates the beauty of the work of art, the necessary beauty of fully formed order. That's necessitated by the line that we draw as human beings between our own perception and the world. You know, this has an aura on the work that we're experiencing. Our experience, vice versa, of the work of art, it comes back through us unto the world, and our perception of the work of art echoes in the world of facts. And this helps us to bring our everyday lives ever further in the limits of meaning. Beethoven created for himself, for his own very peculiar rendition of the world, a very special intelligence. From the smallest axioms of perception, he drew the largest and most advanced results possible. Pierre Boulez has an interesting take on it, and I'll try and summarize it. So, ideas can be tested, experienced. We can see their evolution using tools. These tools develop and deduce further conclusions to the original idea, either bringing it towards modernity and new sounds, either towards the past, finding old ideas in new ones. There is a twist. The twist is that both these operations can be achieved using old and new means, new vectors of translation in music's parameters. On a stage.
Thank you, Mr. Boulez.
Speaking of which, you know, the classical school has sort of a disdain for the micro element, you know, dismissing it as work, preferring to it the lofty heights of drama or form. This changes with Beethoven, and he takes the smallest axioms to make the missa solemnis.
Thank you.
luck or talent, of course. You know, the loneliest someone is, the furthest he'll return to his base perception. The rest is just, to be fair, sublimation. You daredevil Donnelly, I love your piercing lots of lies and your flashy foreign mail. So here's my county card. I dalgo with all my exes, wise and sad. Et toi, Donnelly, grand cryptomane, j'aime ta façon de percer de ta lance les mensonges et l'éclair de ton coursier rapide. Voici ma carte, ostraciste Hidalgo, chevalier de tout voir, tout entendre, tout dire à la triste figure. B's characteristics as a composer, you know, the extension of form to all parameters, you know, micro to macro motions, irregular forms, what it comes down to is perception of time. Time was going faster at the time. Adorno was right. The older the music, the faster we ought to play it. And by faster, I don't just mean speed or drama. That would, you know, add too much color to the whitened ruin. Instead, let's say that the travel of color is the experience of color. That's a beautiful quote, isn't it? It's from James Joyce, for whom conception of art is made only through experience, through actually two travels. Our own travel and the works, you know. The travel of color is the experience of color. When he says experience, is it color experiencing itself? Or is it us experiencing color? Or is it us seeing color in ourselves? You know, we seem to follow Nietzsche's intuition that we are sweetly parallel to each other, you know, with art and the whitened ruins and the travel of color. Sweetly parallel, well, that kind of harkens back to Beethoven, because with his tempi, he wanted us to have an overarching outlook on his work, to experience it with both a shade that wouldn't render everything and a pace that would render a sense of wholeness. He wanted us to take his chair. How can we take him for granted since he didn't take himself for granted? Beethoven goes further because he has a weird relationship to the very small elements, to individual notes and resonances, you know, scratches, whiffs, taps, shovings, wipes. He can't hear them distinctively. Yet it's the only thing he can hear by then. You know, he knows these are a preponderant element. You know, a molecule that will at one point run along the organism that is his work. You know, that's why he's so attached to the power of attacks, because he knows that there is something extra, other than pitch, other than rhythm, other than harmony. The exigence of speed comes from this, to both integrate these scrapes and spiky sounds into the texture of the form and orchestration, and also to blur these very sounds. Of course, it will be strange to perform a work by Beethoven. It is always strange, because we can't hear distinctly. Yet, it's all part of the cathedral of sound. You know, it's all part of a theorem, an equation of incompleteness, but meaningful incompleteness. You know, the gargoyles, the functional ornaments, the colors. You know, colors do have a function. It makes the work breathe life. Beethoven was right. The greater the genius is, the more his descendants will imitate their failings rather than their qualities. Hence, the harm Shakespeare and Michelangelo have done to drama and painting, and the harm being done by Beethoven now. End quote. Composers cannot escape the past forever, you know, claiming newness while so much is unexplored in what we consider to be the light around us. This is a labyrinth, and whatever is at the center is very much alive. Despite you trying to find a way out of it, this isn't one of those labyrinths, mazes, where you have to escape it, you know, to make out, break out the meaning of the work from its own grasp. But, you know, it's one of these old classic labyrinths where there is something precious that's precious at the center. It is at the center. It is at the center. I'd like to make one last observation, a rather despairing one, a frightful one, to be honest. There is a dissolve late in Beethoven's life, maybe a breaking free or a forgetting, meaning that what I just said was wrong about labyrinths, a leaving behind of his will in favor of his spirit. Because Beethoven doesn't just stop using con brio, but also the whole concept of scherzi disappear completely, you know, of scherzi and their entrancing and morphing repetitions. They disappear. The last one, it seems, is from the hammerklavier, and it's already so broken up, so jagged, so unrelentlessly relentless, so antagonistic, so difficult to accept. It seems that we have a case in which a creator just lets go, because the scherzi after that are just not scherzi anymore. I don't know where the breaking point is in this temperament, where in his work it happens. Maybe if there is even a breaking line. Maybe con brio and scherzi, they share something in that Beethoven brought them kind of too close to the sun, and yet kept using features of con brio and scherzi after the hammerklavier. And as these forms to Beethoven turn obsolete, they gain an unforeseen vigor. Tragedy is realizing too late, or not realizing the power of a fact, of a complex. Beethoven doesn't realize fully the extent of deafness, in a way. He isn't able to find a face to his deafness, to the evil that is deafness, because it is so central to him. He has to use it unconsciously as a vector of creation and try and sublime his symptoms through his work. His deafness doesn't have a face to him, though it has traits. It has lines, very much how our lives, our experience of the world, creates a line between the world and the work of art. That's the same with him, his deafness. His own presence on the world, however negative it may be, traces three trajectories between the inner and the outer deafness. This episode is about a man whose face has been taken off. Perception of the world. The world is more and more divided by second, nanoseconds, and therefore we discover the moment.
musical Adam. Some time has passed now, hasn't it? I will not bring you back to 1802, nor to 1810, nor to anywhere in Beethoven's lifetime, because biography, events, end quotes, can only get us so far back and so far forward. I do not reduce their value, nor what they bring to our understanding, because, you know, sometimes a creator explaining his utopia while he hasn't reached it yet, is a good indicator of his own ideas as ideals, of what was going on in his mind. You know, take Busoni, an already very interesting composer, who is interested as a composer in reproducing the tradition of classical drama through modern means and texts, and who as a writer has an entirely different vision of the world. In fact, you know, stemming from the same conflict of emotions through new means. Here's a little story. A fairy-like invention. New York, April 1st, 1911. Wireless dispatch. That we today on March 29th already know publicly what is only appointed to leave New York as a wireless dispatch on the 1st of April will seem less mysterious to the reader after he has finished reading this dispatch. Compared with the discovery revealed here, this tiny anticipation of it seems a mere bagatelle. Note from the editor. An extraordinary discovery is announced from South Park Hill. Kenilton Humphrey Happenseek, the scientist domiciled there, who is highly esteemed in professional circles, but in no way celebrated, has succeeded, thanks to an unusual gift of sharp deduction in arriving at far-reaching conclusions through comparatively simple experiments. Happenseek of late has been occupied with the preparation of a super-sensitive apparatus intended for phonographic discs. The contrivance, which he has perfected at last, resembles at a first glance a drum disc with a super-sensitive epidermis, and possesses the quality of combining the utmost delicacy with the most complete power of resistance, and is able to pick up noises which are inaudible or unintelligible to the human ear. Moreover, it has the power of dissecting complicated sounds into their constituent parts. The contrivance is so extremely delicate that when a hand is passed through hair, the crackling is distinctly audible. Light steps in the room are recorded by it. The slightest breath is impressed on it. Happenseek left his laboratory at 2 o'clock in the morning after he had completed a new and, as he believed, perfect disc, and entered it again at 6 o'clock after a short night's rest. He subjected his disc to an examination by means of a very powerful microscope constructed by him for this purpose, and discovered on it certain impressions which he could not account for. After he had separated the customary noises of the town at night, which he considered as secondary phenomena in this case, he found an accumulation of obscure diagrams which were systematic, complicated, and at first unintelligible. On first consideration, they might have been of musical origin, although they showed only a remote relationship with the musical forms familiar to him. In any case, they must have come from a very great distance. At investigation as to whether, within a 10-mile radius, mere music might have been played that night and during those 4 hours, resulted in a negative answer. But the marks were imprinted, and the disc, when it was brought into rotation,
sounded music without doubt, which, to the scholar's ears, however, remained as unintelligible as the diagrams had been to his eyes. This happened about 6 months ago. In between, Happenzig had been at the work incessantly, and his never-resting mind had succeeded in giving the solution to the riddle and bringing forward a new theory, which fills us with awe and astonishment and opens up the widest prospects. As the air needs an instrument to make its vibrations perceptible to our ear, so the air itself is only an instrument which transmits the not yet fully fathomed wavelengths. These original wavelengths, as Appenzig recognizes, have the characteristic quality of being similarly effective in a time sphere as, for instance, wireless telegraphy in that of space. In time, its effect works as well backwards as forwards, and its intensity decreases correspondingly with the distance. Sound atmospherics put in vibration through exterior inputs continue in both directions. Its impressions will be passed on into the past as well as into the future. A scream fades away into tomorrow and the day after tomorrow and further in corresponding strength, logically into yesterday and the day before yesterday also. Thus, through a chance not yet cleared up, a demonstration of music in the future seems to have found its way onto the supersensitive disc and to have impressed itself there. After laborious calculations, for which quite new estimation will have to be found, the origin of the phonographic marks might lie 20 to 300 years in front of us, according to Happenseeker's assumption. If one takes an average figure, 140 years is the result, so that music written on the disc lies about a century and a half in the future. Sounds from the trombones, like alien harps, melt into a sound fog, and again are the voices out of the void, without audible beginning, disappear into the atmosphere of sound. Sounds as if coming from tinkling water and burning fire assume melodic form, appear and disappear. Intervals are apparently purer and show the aliveness of human breath in their gradations and combinations. Nature itself seems to sound, and we are tempted to suppose that this music never wearies and goes on creating from what is there into infinity. All further details and additions to this sensational discovery we will communicate to our readers punctually and conscientiously every
in your sight.